this is somebody here who we do not expect every year. And I'm really looking forward to this for the main reason that I personally know both gentlemen who are joining the stage very soon. And one of them I know for many years. We are good friends, and I like his outstanding personality and his skill at expressing future trends and developments in words that everybody can understand. And the other gentleman, it was definitely, and he is one of my musical heroes for years. He's a legend, in fact. And when we sat together first time a couple of months ago and talked about a bunch of things, it was so fascinating to see you know, how creative and how inspiring he is. And you definitely enjoy every minute you spend in his company.
Just listen to it, please. Younger people.
At least some of you should recognize this.
Even the younger people know this legend. He sold about over 60 million records worldwide, 5 Grammy Awards. He's one of the legends of pop and rock music of our lifetime, and ranked in the top 10 of Rolling Stone's 100 greatest drummers of all time. What an amazing career. And we are really looking forward to meet right on. He's already behind this big screen, Mr. Stuart Copeland from Police is with us, ladies and gentlemen.
So, I come on, Stuart. Come on here.
Good morning. Let's have some biofeedback. Now, for this kind of thing, this is a tech thing here, so you don't need to applaud. You can just text us, okay, your approval.
So we still have a video to show. Should we do that?
Yeah, let's
just
see the
two-minute video. Catherine, if you can show, just show the video of Stuart as a quick introduction, that would be great.
Our next guest is the drummer for the legendary rock band The Police. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Stuart Copeland.
I must have started playing drums at age 8. And my father, who is a jazz musician, insisted that I have all of the best teachers so I can say that I'm classically trained on the drum. It's a ridiculous statement, but what the hell. I guess you call it suicide. You answered for just one more bad idea. I can still lose them like I can still lose them like streets of London, there was this new phenomenon, the punk revolution. I looked at the band and thinking, I can do that. I am the neatest thing that ever hit town. There isn't anyone who I bother you. Don't care if you really want to hang around. You don't care because I am the
requires a kind of aggressive tone. I mean, you can't even shout properly.
You like watching what I do, don't you, baby? Just watch me.
Stuart, what a career, what a range of projects you're working on. I mean, this is a bit unusual for you.
Well,
I mean, diving into this topic, diving into this community is a bit unusual. So you spent the day with us yesterday, you browsed around a bit. I mean, what do you think about our industry, what we're doing here?
You guys are much healthier. You know, at the NAMM convention, which is the music thing, where instead of incomprehensible booths, God knows what products you've got there. But, you know, in the NAMM, there's drum sets, guitars and stuff. But you guys, you know, musicians all over the place, but you guys look much healthier. You're technically, you're nerds, but obviously as nerds, you work out or something.
All right. So let's welcome the second gentleman here on stage. I think everybody knows him. David Shingi.
Hey, David. Good to have you here.
All right, you guys are sucking too much of this time up for us. You're going to let us get on with this or no?
Before you rock the stage here for the next couple of minutes, one question. And part of the preparation for this session,
right.
I've realized or I've learned that you're a musician as well.
Yeah,
so tell us, are you playing an instrument or are you a singer so that we can maybe swap over to X Factor format here? What are you doing?
Jesus, I didn't think this was going to be about that. I play guitar and sing, but
a bit,
standing next to somebody who's won.
You've been keeping quiet about this, Mr. David.
Six Grammys makes it very intimidating, but thank you. Thanks for turning the heat up in here again.
Are there any plans for a music project together?
Jesus.
We're jamming right now.
Yes,
this is
okay.
It.
So, ladies and gentlemen, be with us when they are jamming on stage. The opening keynote today, David Shingi and Stuart Copeland. It's called The Wake Up Call for You. Welcome to Day 2 DMEXCO 2017 with David Shingi and Stuart Copeland.
Thanks, thanks for coming. Have fun. Bye bye.
Thank you, Christian.
Go on,
thanks,
guys.
Brother. Right. Good morning, everybody. Who went to bed before midnight? Oh my God. 1 o'clock? 2 o'clock? Haven't been to bed at all. See, they're rock stars, brother. This is how that works.
Yeah.
Are we good?
Yeah.
That
used to be me when I was young.
I think this introduction of Stuart has been remarkable. What was left out, brothers and sisters, is the fact that he's pivoted his career. He's a true polymath. Those of you who don't know who The Police is, they just landed from Mars, one of the most iconic bands of our time. It is intimidating, yet an honor to spend some time with you. We're going to spend a little bit of time talking about the past, the present, and the future. It's going to be a very simple segue. We have 20 minutes. I need to get into it. Are we cool? I'm going to say, are we cool, humans? Amen.
Yeah.
So let's get on with this thing.
Go on, text your approval.
The question I have, which I think everybody has, so post-punk, or really punk rock in 1977 when you formed Police, where'd the name come from?
Oh, it was written on the side of a police car.
It was
like easy promotion. You guys are all here. You're all marketing people, right? Brand recognition. Hello. The Police. You've all heard of that brand, right? And it was at a time of hostility in band names, you know. Evil Edna's Horror Toilet. The Clash, you know, the Sex Pistols. These were all the Damned, who've all grown up now and they have children. They refer to the old days as my old band, The Darned. But it was all about hostility, and The Police just seemed like a hostile name. It started out as, can I use language here?
Oh, please do.
Fuck the Police. But we were persuaded just to go with The Police.
It could have been FTP, and we'd all understand that too, man.
Yeah.
We are nerds.
But by the way, for all you branding folks, it was a bad choice, because we don't own it.
Oh.
You look up, you Google Police, and you get the New Orleans Police Department.
We'll get to branding soon, man. I want to ask you some more questions about the past. What's your favorite moment with The Police?
Favorite moment might have been, most of them were in the early days before we made it, those little incremental steps. You know, people say, what does it feel to me? You know, when we first headlined at the Marquee Club on Wardour Street in London for 250 people, we've made it, this is it, we've arrived. And then the mountain, as when you climb any mountain, it seems to get bigger, and finally we're at Shea Stadium. Okay, this is it, right? And it did finally seem, we can look and we can see all the way around us, okay, this must be it, okay, so we quit.
Is that your least
favorite
moment?
No, but my favorite moment was, I think, Shea Stadium, which was all of our dues that we paid, all that we'd put into it, and you know, to be there with 80,000 people on a beautiful evening, and just the sound was perfect, just everybody was perfect, it was like, it all came together, the very best, on that night. It just felt great.
And what's your worst moment with The Police?
Worst moment? I don't know. take 542 of whatever song that was. I think every little thing she does is magic.
Really?
We tried the reggae version, we tried the punk version, we tried the rock version, the blues version, the polka version, you know. But what we were really avoiding was that Stingo had brought in a platinum demo. If he had just released his demo that he made at home, it would have been a hit just like that. But when you're a young musician in a rock band, you instinctively recoil and you want to put your own thing on it, which we did. But eventually we ended up recording on his demo. He just said, okay, god damn it, okay, just play that demo and count me through the changes, show me where the chords are, I'll show you how this isn't going to work. One take, and that's the record that you're all familiar with. That one take of every little thing she does is magic was me cheesed off and him going, chorus, okay, here's a chorus, verse, no, bridge. And that kind of chaotic feel infused all of our music. We didn't rehearse before we recorded albums. Next time you hear a Police album, consider this, that the drummer never heard that song 20 minutes before the performance that got recorded and that I'm stuck with for the rest of my life. You know, you go out on tour, you figure out how to get from the chorus back down to the verse. Ah, that's slick. I wish I had done that on the record. But the record kind of didn't suck. So it's interesting how sometimes with art, you want to catch it au point. Not when it's fully boiled, when it's fully baked, when it's fully cooked. You want to get it when it's still changing. And I think that is something that you can hear in Police records, that kind of, that sizzle of uncertainty.
Uncertainty. So talking about that, though, when was the pinch the moment for you, pinch yourself moment when you realized that you guys were on a success path?
One afternoon, we were in New York City, and we got a phone call saying, boys, the money has landed. You are rich young men. Up to that point, we'd seen the record in the charts. We'd gotten the buzz of the excitement. We'd, you know, felt that we're a hit band, and that was enough. But the part that we were hardly even thinking about was, boys, you're rich. Money! Well, we were in New York City, and on 47th Street was a store called Manny's. Big, huge music store. The three blonde heads went down there and bought everything. I'll have one of those, two of those, one of those. And what did you get, Andy? Yeah, I want one of those too. And so that afternoon, we played at my father's place on Long Island, the sound check from hell, with all of our new amps, toys, Taurus foot pedals, wah-wah, you know, every gadget. We were there at the sound check, plugging everything, trying to play with all of our new toys. That was a pinch me moment.
Holy shit. Amazing. For those who don't know, since The Police, Stuart's gone on to have an amazing career in composition, TV shows, film, games. You even did some work for BlackBerry.
That, by the way, is a sweet spot of my composing career. The thing that I brag to my composer friends about is that thing. They paid me for a logo. I think if I can remember the tune, what they paid me for that hard fee, cash money, so that they own it as if they wrote it. I figured out that what they paid me, each of those five notes would put one of my kids through college for a year. Is composing, when it's distilled down to that, you know, that's when you've composed. The guy who wrote bum 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 bum, he's above me, because that's four notes. But still, I'm pretty proud of my five-note trick.
Holy shit. So given that you've gone from an actor to a supporting actor, what's the biggest change you've seen in the industry, particularly when it pertains to technology and the advances?
The big change is what technology has provided, funnily enough. And what the technology has provided is a throwing wide of the gates of creativity so that any damn fool with a laptop can create a hit. You don't need to have gone to music school. You don't need to be autistic and sit in the, you know, Asperger's syndrome playing guitar. You don't need any of that. You just need a creative mind and a laptop, and any damn fool can now make music. It's good for the world and good for culture that the bar is lowered because the talent pool is that much wider. But the problem is that if you're one of those guys making your record, you're in competition with every damn fool. And so it's harder to make it. It's harder to have that mega hit. But the good part is the really important cultural part is that it's easy for each and every one of you to make music. And music is therefore going back to its original purpose for our hunter-gatherer species, which is campfire music. Music, at the point of specialization where I get to be the specialist and you get to watch and just sit there and take it, is kind of being replaced by an era where we all are playing music around the campfire together. It doesn't take specialization. Anyone can do it, and that's what music's purpose really is, for everyone to do it.
But then doesn't that create
competition? Yes.
Well, if it's going to be democratized, doesn't that mean that it's also homogenized? So is there going to be the ability for punk to be invented if it's all about rock and roll? Or do you feel like it's so many splintered genres now that it's become super unique?
Good question, but I'm just going to make up, you know, just thinking about this right now, a snap answer would be that no. I would think that if you open it up so that you can just have a wild idea and actually create it and do it, there's more possibilities for variety than there would be is if the music business was constrained. You have to get a record deal. You have to go to an expensive studio and have somebody pay for it, which means you got to go to the man, which means you got to be your peg needs to fit the shape of the hole. And that, I would say, would be more homogenizing than throwing the gates wide open. So I'm just making that up. I mean, anyone else have an opinion on that? I just think, you know, a wider gene pool is going to create more variety. For example, Moby. As far as I know, Moby doesn't play guitar. As far as I know, he's not much of a singer. Piano, nuh-uh. He's a really creative, talented artist, but he didn't use the traditional tools of being a musician. He used his imagination and a laptop and created something that was very effective in the wide world. Real art. So he's pretty unique.
And this audience is primarily marketing tech. So Marcom tech really is the audience. These guys represent brands that we consume. If you're already talking about technology and how it's changed the music industry, how do you think things, certainly one of the topics du jour for us is AI, so artificial intelligence. Do you think that artificial intelligence will help the creativity path, or is it going to hinder the creativity path when it comes to music particularly?
I'm not relaxed about AI at all. The first intrusion of technology into the primal pulse of music. You know, one of the functions of music is that it's the human mating dance. And out on the disco floor, when music is playing, music permits us to do weird. This is weird, right? You know, because there's no music playing. If there's music playing and you don't do that, there's something wrong with you. So music gives you permission to get into very strange body language, to demonstrate the superiority of your genes. You know, go figure. Hey, I didn't write the program. So this is a very primal thing, rhythm and dancing. That's right down to our crocodile brain. That's right, that's really basic, right? Guess what? On the disco floor, a machine supplies the rhythm better than a human drummer. So this really animal part of ourselves is stimulated by a machine. The next step, a human programmed that machine. The next step, which is what you're all thinking about, is when a machine programs that machine. And guess what? You know, it turns out that music is actually very mathematical, the way harmony works. Rhythm is absolutely arithmetic. The rhythm, time is subdivided in most of our music into four beats in a bar and 16 bars in a phrase, et cetera, et cetera. It's actually very mathematical. The way chords move, the tension created by this chord resolves into that chord because of physics. To a certain amount, we're trained in, you know, our Western ears are trained to accept Western, you know, what do they call it, the well-tempered, you know, it's actually not, they've stretched it so this chord works here and it works there and it works there, even though the physics are slightly warped, our ears have learned it. But a machine could figure out how to create tension with this chord here, which resolves into that chord there. The machine can be taught and know that a 4-4 rhythm with oots, 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 people are gonna love that. So I'm not sanguine at all. I think machines one day will be writing music that we'll all love.
All right, then I'm gonna, let me pivot on that ever so slightly. If I'm gonna go listen to a band, I want to see the human play the machine. Whatever that is, analog, guitar.
My daughter doesn't.
However, if we're thinking about the live experience, she does turn up to see some experience. Do you see that technology is going to make the audience experience experiencing any type of music better? So for example, Coldplay, the RFID band, where they're able to make a light show all happen where in their sequence, they're able to say, I now want everybody to look pink as opposed to lighters when you were playing back in the day. Do you think that then that creates a whole different type of experience that takes it away from the actor and into the audience? And do you think the technology is going to influence the live experience?
That, I think, is a kind of a cool gimmick. I haven't seen it, so maybe better than that. Maybe I shouldn't judge. But I'll bet you the lighting guy who's done lights and is all about lighting, I'll bet you he's going to do a better job than the wristband thing. And if he could activate everybody's wristband, that'd probably be even better. But as far as wanting to see live musicians, that's what they all said about the album. People are going to want to hold it in their hands. People are going to want an album cover. People want to hold by a thing. Wrong. I took my daughter to the Hollywood Bowl to see Flying Lotus. The support act was Parliament Funkadelic. 14 guys on the stage, so running around singing, just it's all going on. I'm thinking, now this is how you do a show. Watch closely, my daughter. This is music. And she was, you know, when are they going to finish? I'm waiting for Flying Lotus. And so they leave, and Flying Lotus comes out. One guy in a bunch of screens, and this is his show. He's not even singing. Okay, Casey, yeah, oh-ho, you know. And my daughter was transfixed by the light show. She didn't care. I mean, the one human being on the stage was not what she was looking at everything else. And by the way, a very creative, incredible show. I'm not casting, dispersions at all, but she was more impressed by the technology than by 14 guys running around the stage.
Okay. What about AR and VR?
Oh, you're going to try and get me now.
Yeah,
right?
No. I'm going to circle around some subjects, man. We'll land somewhere.
We all want to believe that us humans are in control, but we're not, and you all know it. We are not in control of the future.
You guys are inventing
stuff that you don't even know how it's going to turn out.
What about AR and VR, then? Do you feel that experience is something that, take your daughter, would she be immersed in wearing a pair of VRs on? As opposed to, or an AR experience, so holding something up that gives a physical to digital experience. Do you think that would actually give them a greater connection than watching the DJ with the groovy headset as opposed to the fantastical 3D light show in 360?
I'm not sure what she would make of all that, but I sure want to check it out. Sounds like a lot of fun. I don't see any problem with that at all.
Okay, so you think that the immersive experience will be at least intriguing? To extend the experience to say, instead of it being about the actor here, the audience can be completely immersive. You haven't experienced a lot of AR and VR yet?
No, I have not. But an interesting kind of parallel topic, yesterday at lunch, this is the kind of event this is, where I'm sitting there at lunch, and right across from me is a famous German astronaut who was up on Mir Station. Dang, they got some folks here to hang with, you know. And he had a couple, you know, the poor guy didn't get to eat his lunch because everybody else at the table was, what's it like? What's weightlessness like? Oh, tell me, what was the take on? The poor guy was, his chicken sat there on his plate while everybody at the table grilled him about his experience in space. But one thing interesting about what we're talking about is that he said one of the effects of the loss of gravity is that you lose a connection with your body. A lot of your sense of your body and its position, its placement, your physicality is because of gravity. And when you lose the gravity and you go like that and you fly, you become just a, as he put it, you become just a consciousness.
Mm. Yeah.
And okay, you've got some equipment, so if you want to actually manipulate something, you can do so. But actually, you sort of forget about your body. Boy, doesn't that sound great?
Yeah, and you, by the way, the way you articulated the glass felt very weightlessness, by the way, which was interesting. When you did your career success with the police, your career happened because really it was an analog world. There was no social platforms.
We had to actually play that stuff.
Imagine that. And you also had to go from radio station to radio station, from town to town to town to town.
Yeah.
How do you feel about the social platforms today in the world that we live in where it's all really about personal expression is a new form of entertainment? Do you think it's a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, you can cover a lot more ground in an easier space, we used to have to go to Minneapolis and Chicago and Des Moines. In each city, we'd have to go to the radio station, laugh at all the DJ's jokes and hang out, and hopefully he'll play the record in that city. And then we got to go do the same thing in the next city, in the next city. Nowadays, it's one guy in New York makes all those decisions. I found this out with Oysterhead. We said, come on, guys, we're in Seattle. Let's go hit the radio stations. Look, Mr. Van Winkle, it's not like that anymore. It's one guy in New York, and you got to pay him a lot of money. It's not just, you know, a little line of cocaine or something. You got to pay him hundreds of thousands of dollars to get your record added all over the country. That makes it easy in one sense, but homogenized in the other. Mm. But the cool thing is that a recent experience I had out there on the promo trail was they said, this thing's called sessions. Where you show up in a little, there's some site somewhere and they got a little studio and a couple little amps and just play your guitar. It's like unplugged. I mean, it's just really low key and it doesn't matter if you're out of tune. It's just no low expectation. So I go, sure, okay, I got a record to flog. So I go and do the thing and sing the thing. Okay, as I'm walking out of the studio, getting in the car, leaving, 230,000 people just saw that. Whoa, I just played two stadiums. I'm glad I didn't know that when I'm up there just hamming it up. Because you're in just a little studio. Mm. But so you can really hit hard and wide with very little effort. Bad news, you got to go out and play shows to earn a living because your records are being pirated. Good news, at least you can promote them one-stop promoting. You hit one of these little things and hundreds of thousands of people get it.
Do you think that's a sustainable model for, you know, it really... Music is just part of it. The entertainment industry as a whole, you're across it, from music to film to television. It has the same sort of problem, I suspect, because it doesn't cost 99 cents to produce a piece of music, right? It costs a lot more money than that. So you have
Actually,
to go out and do live.
That's not true.
Oh, yeah?
You can make music for free.
Yeah.
If you've got a laptop, you can make music for free.
Hmm. If that's the case, do you then believe that live is the only way that becomes sustainable for somebody who's a new musician to make money? So if you're able to produce music for free,
yeah,
and you're able to then democratize your ability for that to be seen,
yeah,
how does a musician make money, do you think, moving forward?
You see, that's the that's the problem. That's the fly in the ointment. Mm-hmm. How do you make money from all this? Mm-hmm. I had a YouTube channel, which I created videos. Snoop Dogg, you just saw Snoop Dogg came down to Sacred Grove. Yeah. Stanley Clark, Ben Harper, Neil Peart, you know, all these musicians, they come over and hang, and it's all wired. So I hit one button, there's no engineer in the room, I hit one button and every square foot in the room is in record. It's all mic'd up, the drums are mic'd up, the timpani is, you know, and my buddies come over, they forget, because there's no engineer, it's just me, I hit one red button, no engineer. So they just jam, and I've got six cameras around the room, and I shoot everything. They go home, I cut it up, put a little movie up on YouTube for free for all the people to enjoy. And that, I do that for free. My budget is zero, nothing. Mm. And so I got me a YouTube channel. I went down to Maker Studios, I cut a deal, I got a label. Okay, I'm in business, YouTube channel. And I was waiting for the money to come rolling in. And finally, I did get my first royalty statement. Oh my God, I had earned over $1. And at that point, it became all about the money, folks. I'm sorry, so shoot me. $2 by Christmas, darn it. And as it happens, last night, this Maker Studio, they were sold to Disney. Everybody was, you know, they lost a big disaster. I don't know, you know what happened. They were nice folks, actually. I love them. But, last night I was having dinner with a guy who used to be in charge of monetizing at Maker Studios. And I said, by the way, I got that statement and I called up Neil Peart and I said, dude, we're in the money. Beer, okay, not a whole beer, like about a half a beer for all of us. We each get one sip, but hey, look, we're in. And but I actually never got that $1, never saw it. Last night at dinner, he gave me this. I'm paid up.
That's a euro. I think that's actually worth more than a dollar.
That's $2.
So let's not talk about monetization. We're going to run out of time. I knew this 20 minutes would go pretty quickly. I have some very short questions for you. You cool?
Sure.
Best piece of career advice you've ever been given and by whom?
By whom?
Yeah.
By my father. The answer is yes. Anyone here play French horn? Yes. Yep. I got it. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yep. The answer is yes.
The answer is yes. I love that. The next question for me is really simple. If you weren't a musician, what would you be?
If I
weren't a musician, what would you be?
Preacher.
Oh, really? Yeah, that works. Amen.
Because my heart is full of love for all of you. I can take you up there. Send money. Tax-free.
We get the theme. Isn't that amazing?
And by the way, thank you. Just text your approval. By the way, it's a great product. It really works to the extent that you believe it, just like Disney. If you believe the magic, it's true. Hey, faith healing is all the same. It's a great product. You pay for it whatever you want to pay. Send $1, send $10. That is a great product, which I wish I actually was in the business of selling.
I have 1,000 more questions for Stuart, but we're out of time. We're going to take this offline. You guys have been amazing, indulging in our personal conversation up here. Give it up for Stuart Copeland, a living Levin and a polymath.
Thank you.
Thank you, brother. A preacher. Of course he's a preacher.